some who want to clap and move. So we can. Let's sweetly echo.
Sweetly echo the gospel call. Wonderful words of God. Offer pardon and peace to all. Wonderful words of God. Jesus, lovely Savior, sanctify forever. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of God. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful.
Promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises. Something that I wonder how many of us is that, are those guys up there? Which one of them happens to be us? You know, I love my little girl Jessica. So cute when she was little and as a baby. We still got the videos of it. You know how kids are? Grabbing food, shoving it in their mouth, some of it even staying in their mouth on occasion. And you have to get those cute, precious little bibs too. Because, you know, most of that food isn't going in the first time or at all, and they're just going to get covered with it. But she was so cute, and it was worth it, at least then. Of course, if when she's 16 and still needs a bib and a vacuum cleaner, it won't be cute at all. But, you know, part of maturing physically is learning to feed yourself. And the same is true with maturing spiritually. Part of spiritual maturity is learning to feed yourself from God's Word. Now, we're in a series called Back to Basics, where we are exploring some of the basic aspects of being a Christian, and learning to study the Bible is one of those basics. Now, let me ask you guys a question. How many of you text with your phone? Raise your hands. A lot of you do. How many of you have a cell phone? Okay, most of you do now. You know, it's amazing how quickly texting has become a normal mode of communication. You know, when texting first started, I really didn't get into it. I'm a communicator. I love to talk to people. Now I pretty much text all the time. And of course, I still love to talk to folks. But there is a convenience associated with quick text, though not necessarily having 30 conversations at once with people 5 feet from you. It has to be used appropriately. You know, but nowadays, I can't imagine, you know, people not texting. It's just become such a part of our life. Well, I wonder what it would be like if God sent you a text. Wouldn't you want to read it? And basically, God did send us a text. It's called the Bible. Today, we're going to talk about how to feed ourselves from God's Word. Because if you want to grow to spiritual maturity, you can't do it without the Bible. Jesus said in Matthew 4:4, says, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." You see, when you learn to feed on God's Word at home, it's like learning how to eat. This week, I have had a bit of a wake-up call about that. I have some bad food habits. I like fast food. I like convenient food, food on my terms and how I want it. And this week, that got me a blood pressure of 140 over 100, which is just a little high. And, you know, it's been up, and I know it has been up. It took me a while to face it, but I am, and now I'm doing the right things. But, you know, God's Word is the same. Many of us have bad habits. We grab a little when it is convenient, in a spare moment, or when we need a quick bite. We catch our little verse of the day on our Facebook or on our Bible apps, and we think that's going to sustain us. We know it isn't healthy, but we do it anyways. Don't wait till a spiritual crisis moment to realize you don't have what you need inside you. You need to get it right now. When you do, you'll find that when you come to church, it's like fine dining. You've been prepared an exquisite dining experience here, but you're not starving yourself spiritually all week till then. The body does better. It's more healthy when it's filled. It reacts better to better foods when you're not quite so hungry. If you don't believe me, go 3 days without eating and then eat you a nice big old steak with a loaded baked potato and some barbecue beans and a big old loaf of bread. See how your body reacts to that. God's Word's the same way. If we're just getting little bites throughout the week and we come to church, Our spiritual man is not fully prepared to receive this word that's here. We immerse ourselves in God's word throughout the week, then when we come into his house, we're prepared to receive the banquet that he's laid out before us. You know, as we dive into this study on Bible study, I want to give you four decisions that you need to make if you're going to grow to spiritual maturity. The first decision is that you need to accept the Bible as your authority. You need to accept the Bible as your authority. You know, a lot of our furniture these days comes RTA, ready to assemble. I used to have to put together a lot of cribs when I first started out in retail. A lot of ready to assemble cribs. I would advise parents on which one was the best one to buy based on how many nicks and cuts I got while putting it together. But you know what? Following the directions was a very important part about putting that furniture together. Now, guys generally don't like to be told how to build anything. We're a little stubborn and on the proud side. We often launch into projects without reading the directions. Sometimes we're able to get it put together without the instructions, but when we can, it takes us a lot more time than it should have. Reading and following instructions is the best way. Now, I'll be honest, personally, I'm a directions guy. I know I'm one of the weird ones, but I think it does come from my time in retail. There is nothing more annoying than having someone call you and ask you all of these questions only to discover they have not read the instruction manual. Fellas, on a side note, don't tell your mother-in-law that you will help them only after they have read all the directions. That doesn't work out well. Just on a side note, they never forget. Now listen, I will help answer any question I can and will help any way I can. But if you have a concern or something you don't understand, read the manual. Let's read God's word and then let's sit down and figure it out together. Because understand, I am not your authority. Dr. Ron is not your authority. We are your guides, but God's word, that is your authority. That's why to grow to spiritual maturity, we have to accept the Bible as our authority. It's God's way of showing us how to live. Psalms 19, 7 and 8 says, "The instructions of the Lord are perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The commandments of the Lord are right, bringing joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are clear, giving insight for living." Lots of people claim to be an authority. And we will make life-altering decisions based on what someone who is an authority says. But a person will never grow to spiritual maturity in the faith without accepting the Bible as the authority in their lives. That takes us to the second decision that you need to make. A conscious decision that you need to agree with the goal of studying the Bible. You need to agree with the goal of studying the Bible. James 1:22, one of the first pieces of scripture I memorized back in high school, it says, "But prove yourselves doers of the word and not merely hearers who delude themselves." As you continue on in the passage, it says, "For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. For once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. But one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, and abides by it, not having become a forgetful hearer but an effectual doer, this man will be blessed in what he does." We need to understand that the goal of studying the Bible is not simply to increase our knowledge. It is to change our lives. For us to do what it says, that's how our lives change. There is a difference between knowledge and wisdom. I know a lot of people who have a lot of knowledge, and some of them are idiots. Many of them we call politicians. They've got a lot of knowledge. They don't really know what to do with it, not doing anything with it at all. We have to do what the Word of God says, and that will change our lives. Now, Paul, when he was writing his second letter to Timothy, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, he says, all scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate and equipped for every good work. That word inspired, it means breathed by. God breathed all scripture into the hearts of the authors who wrote it down for us. That's the kind of authority the Bible carries. It's not just an ancient religious book. It was not an act of human will, but men moved by the Holy Spirit who spoke from God. Now, this verse in 2 Timothy, this is a big one to me, and we must be fully prepared to act on it. We cannot say, I believe God's word to be perfect and not accept this verse. I mean, oh, we love the teaching. We'll sit here and be taught till the games come on this afternoon. But reproof or being called out on our rebellion, we're not a big fan. Correction, having to actually change our ways, not interested. Training in righteousness, and by the way, training involves time and application and usually a little bit of pain. But we just don't seem to have time for that. We need to accept this verse in its entirety. And that means there are going to be times we're going to have to change the way we live our lives. And this is why we need to make decision number three. You need to decide to grow spiritually. You need to decide to grow spiritually. If you want to grow spiritually, you have to take responsibility for it. Too many Christians blame others for the fact that they aren't growing. In Paul's first letter to Timothy, he says, but have nothing to do with worldly fables fit only for old women. On the other hand, discipline yourself for the purpose of godliness. Understand that you are responsible to God for your growth as a Christian. Let me say that again. You are responsible for your growth as a Christian. The church is here to assist, to train, and encourage, but if you don't assume that responsibility, you will never reach maturity. That's why getting into God's Word and studying for yourself is so very important. It's one of the marks of a person who's serious about the things of God. Look at a situation that happened to Paul. He was preaching in Thessalonica, and a group of Jews and rabble-rousers caused trouble for him. They ran him out. So he goes to the next town, and when the same group heard that he was gaining ground, they showed up. But look at the town of Berea's response. We see it in Acts 17:11. It says, now these were more noble-minded than those in Thessalonica, for they received the word with great eagerness, examining the scriptures daily, 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 to see whether these things were so. They were hungry for the word, and they opened it up. And day in and day out, they were checking the scriptures. Is this what he's saying? Is this correct? Sure enough, it is. We're reading God's word. Don't just take our word for it that what's up there is correct. Do you have your Bible? Do you have it open? Are you following along? Are you going home? Are you taking some time during the week, taking the message notes and opening God's Word and studying it for yourself? Paul was proud of this town because they were examining the Scriptures daily to see whether those things were so. See, we've got to make our fourth decision. We need to learn to study the Bible. We need to learn to study the Bible. There is one type of Bible that doesn't do anyone any good. It's a closed one. If you never open it, you're never going to get anything out of it. In fact, 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman who needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now, there's a difference between reading the Bible in a quiet time and studying the Bible. What's the difference? Effort. You are going to have to put some effort into studying God's Word. It's not just going to pick it up, read a passage, and move on. You know, a quiet time is what Dr. Ron talks about when he says read the Bible every morning. This might take 5, might take 10, might take 20 minutes. Quiet time is something you do every day to spend time with God, just enjoying His presence. But Bible study is different from that. When Paul wrote 2 Timothy 2:15, he described the person who would basically roll up his sleeves and go to work, to get sweaty. Bible study is compared to devotional reading, is where you're going to dig into the Scriptures for a longer period of time, to shoot for a more in-depth look into the Bible. So here's the secret of good Bible study. First, ask questions. Ask questions. The more questions that you ask, the more you will learn about the tech. It's like a good reporter. Ask who, what, when, where, why, and how. If you keep asking these questions, the Bible will open up to you in amazing ways. You will deepen your understanding of God and the Christian life. Now, there's more than one way to study the Bible. But here are a few that are really helpful. Most of these are in your notes, and I'm going to add one. First of all, character study. Pick a character in the Bible and study them. Pick somebody out of the Old Testament, New Testament. Find out how they weave together. If you're going to do a New Testament character study, you've got a lot of different books that you may end up going through. Find out how they were going during the life of Christ, after the life of Christ, building up the new church. In the Old Testament, how they were seeking God's face, how they were learning, how they were growing, how they were calling the nation of Israel, maybe, to follow God. It's fascinating, some of the characters that are in the Bible. How about a theme study? Maybe pick one of my favorite themes is the armor of God. Love the study of the armor of God. That's a favorite one for me. Another one is the gifts of the Spirit. Love to do a study on the gifts of the Spirit. You're going to go through a number of different books on the Bible, and you're going to learn these different gifts and how they were applied. But pick a theme, something that fascinates you. Study it. Maybe a book overview study. Pick a book and just go through it. I'm going through Timothy right now, the first one, and then I'll go through 2 Timothy. And basically, I started by reading the whole book. Now I'm kind of coming back chapter by chapter and absorbing that. And then I'll go back in piece by piece and chunk by chunk and get a good grasp on the book of Timothy. That takes us to that book verse by verse study. You go through and just take tiny little bites and see what is God trying to tell you. In a situation like this, I like to have a couple of different translations to see how they put things. A lot of times I'll take a translation like Holman Christian or New American or the one you're most comfortable with, and I'll partner it up with The Message. The Message was more of a looser contemporary translation, but it puts it in a way that can be a little eye-opening sometimes, a modern type presentation to it. I like to put those together and do a study that way. Maybe a word study. You track one word throughout the whole Bible, or maybe just through the New Testament. Pick one word. Break out the old concordance. I remember growing up with a concordance that was this thick, the old chocomule design. Nowadays, they do have them online. They take up a whole lot less space, but whatever you're comfortable with, pick a word and see how it goes through the Bible. Now, I'm going to add one more. Memorization. We're talking about this in our Sunday school class this morning. How many of you, when you were kids, VBS, Sunday school, memorized Scripture? A lot of us did. A lot of us did. All right? How many of you in the last month memorized a Scripture? Got a handful. Last 3 months? 6 months? A year? God's Word says, "Your Word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you." Why are we not hiding God's Word in our heart? Why are we not taking the time to memorize God's Scripture? I have a youth pastor absolutely loved. His name was Richard Crisco. He was very concerned about his student group. He wanted to make sure that we were learning God's Word, that we were developing as disciples. So he came up with a discipleship plan, 12-week long. It involved Bible reading and prayer and keeping a journal of the things that we were learning and studying, but every week we had to learn a new piece of scripture. At the end of that 12 weeks, we actually had to take a blank piece of paper and write down all those scriptures. If we graduated, it was great. But you know what? A lot of the scripture that I know today, I learned from that time in my life in high school and in college. We need to memorize scripture. I'm going to give you a few to jot down. I'm going to challenge you over the next few weeks to memorize some scripture. Here they are, Romans 3:23. Romans 6:23. John 3:16. Most of you should know that one. Romans 5:8. John 14:4. Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. Revelations 3:20. You go and you memorize those verses, you can lead any person to Christ. It's what he challenged us with the very first verses to ever learn. Because you know what? If we're called to go out and make disciples, we kind of need to know what to share. And you never know when you're going to meet somebody and you don't maybe have that Bible with you, but you can still have God's Word. Take the time, take the opportunity to go and memorize Scripture. Because it's there when you need it. In the armor of God, it talks about the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God in the original translation. That's a quick word from God. The belt of truth referred to God's Word. It held everything together. The sword of the Spirit was a rhema. It was a quick word of God. It was there right when you needed it. You memorize Scripture when you need that quick word, something to help you in a situation right where you're at. If you've got it memorized, it's right there. Memorize Scripture. Take the opportunity to do that while you're studying God's Word. Finally, we're going to look about the devotional method. Very popular method, very simple method. It's the simplest method because you don't have any helps. You don't need a Bible dictionary or any other tool. All you need is a Bible. And there's three steps to the devotional method of studying the Bible. Step one, pray. Pray. Don't underestimate the power of asking God to open your eyes to His Word. We know in Ephesians, he says, pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. He wants us to come to Him. You know, Psalms 119:18, it says, open my eyes that I may see wonderful things in your law. When you sit down to study God's Word, say, Lord, show me something and help me to understand it and then give me a chance to apply it. Back in college, that was the big thing. Experiential learning was the term. Basically, study it and then go out and do it so you can better understand it. So pray, God, show me something new. Help me to understand it. And here's the hard one. Put me in a situation where I can use it. By the way, that's going to get you out of your comfort zone. Be prepared, but that's where you grow. It goes back into that training thing. So pray as you get into His Word. Step two, meditate. We need to meditate on God's Word. Now, meditation doesn't mean you get into the lotus position. Most of us could not bend our legs in some pretzel way underneath us. And even if we could, we'd never get out again. But meditation is seriously thinking. It's giving serious thought to a subject. Psalms 1:1-2 says, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked or stand in the way of sinners or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. How many of you have ever worried about anything before? Anyone ever worried about anything? You've meditated. You've seriously thought about it. You've contemplated. You've dwelled on it. When we worry, we play that thing over and over and over in our mind, don't we? When you do that with God's Word, you're meditating. So be prepared that that passage of Scripture that you're studying, meditate on it throughout the day. Continue to think about it. Look for those opportunities to apply it. Think about it. Lord, how can I use this verse today? How can this impact my life? How can this impact a friend of mine's life? That maybe I can encourage them with it. Find ways and places to use them throughout the day. Meditate on it. And step three, you have to apply it. You absolutely have to apply God's word. Take what you've just learned and make an application of it to your life. John 13, 17, it says, "Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them." This is where the rubber meets the road. And it doesn't matter how much we know if we don't do anything with it. Remember what James wrote? Prove yourselves doers of the word and not merely hearers who delude themselves. If you sit in here and you hear God's word and you don't do anything with it, Bible says you're delusional. You're deluding yourselves. You need to do something with it. So let's take a scripture and we're going to learn how you apply what you learn in your Bible study. Actually, we're going to take two. The first one is Philippians 2:14. Do everything without complaining and arguing. Now, we can read that and we can just say, oh, that's nice. Praise the Lord. Do everything without complaining. Or we can stop. We can say, am I a complainer? Do I argue unnecessarily? See, I'm going to watch myself this week and note every time I complain, every time I feel like arguing with someone, I'm going to stop, pray, and remind myself of this verse. Now, that's how you begin to apply God's word to your life. Now, I'm going to give you one more. This is a sidebar. This is like bonus content on a movie. This is what happens when you get the youth pastor up here. Here's one more for parents and future parents. For anyone who may teach parents, we find this one back in Deuteronomy 6. This is Moses speaking to the nation of Israel. They've been wandering around for 40 years. The whole generation's died off. He's got a new generation getting ready to go in the promised land. He's trying to give them a good pep talk, a good reminder of these things. And he says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. These words which I'm commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates." Parents, future parents, are you diligently teaching your kids the Word of God? In your home and out, when you walk with them, when you play with them, when they're hurt, in every instance, is God's Word on your heart and are you instilling it in them? Because understand, you have the God-given responsibility to train and to teach. It's not me, and it's not the Sunday school teacher, it's not a private school teacher. You have the God-given responsibility. We are tools. But you have the responsibility to train up your kids. So are you? And more so, are you following God's word in such a way that you can teach them? You know, if you think about it, when you're on an airplane, the flight attendant gets up, going through all the motions, she says, in case we lose compression, we lose air in the cockpit, what's going to happen? The masts are going to fall down. And what does she say? If you have children, put it on yourself first. Then put it on your child. And they don't tell you that because they want you to be selfish. They don't tell you that because, you know, they don't want you to think about your child. But it's the fact that if you can't breathe, you can't take care of your kids. If you cannot breathe in God's word, if you haven't allowed it to fill your life, you can't pass it on to your kids. Parents, future parents, anyone who works with kids, who can influence a parent, apply the word of God. Here's God's desire for you, church. that you get into God's Word and let God's Word get into you. We want to help you take the next step and begin studying God's Word. First, if you don't own a Bible of your own, I mean, this could be your next step. If you need one, we've got some copies back on the Welcome Center table. Just pick one up. It's what they're there for. If you need a copy of God's Word, get it and get into it. Personalize it. Mark it up. Write in it. Underline passages. Highlight verses that have exceptional meaning for you. Have a study Bible that you can study on. You know, I have my electronic copies on my iPad. I love it. I read through them. They're great. But when it comes time to study God's Word and get into it, I got a pencil in my hand because I'm writing, I'm taking notes, I'm underlining things. I'm trying to find my old Bible that I had through high school because it's just marked up. I'd love to be able to find it and kind of go through and remember the things that God was showing me back in high school and college. But get into God's Word. You know, you show me a Bible that's all marked up, I'll show you a life that's been marked by the Bible. Secondly, enroll in a good Sunday school class. Be an active part of our Sunday morning Bible study program here, and we'll help you get into God's Word. That's what it's there for. And we call it Sunday school because there's teaching involved. And no, we're not going to specifically go to a person and ask you to read a passage out of the Bible or pray or answer questions, but we do like volunteers. But you don't have to. But we want you to be a part. We want you to grow and to learn. And you know what? I would be willing to say, Sunday school teachers, if somebody in your class called you up during the week with a question, I have a feeling you guys would be more than happy to help them any way you can, wouldn't you? Don't just look at your Sunday school teachers as a Sunday morning only thing. I promise you they'll encourage you throughout the week. Parents, if this is what you want for your kids, like I said, you have to model it for them. You have to bring them. Now, we have a van that goes out and picks up a lot of kids, and it's very encouraging the number of kids that we're bringing to church. But you know what? They can't get him by themselves. Somebody has to bring them in. We've got a van doing that, but you know what? I'd love to see parents bringing their kids. Pray for that. If spiritual maturity is what we want for ourselves, then we have to do more than just know this stuff. We have to do it. The first step to growing spiritually may be coming to know the author of the Bible personally. And if you have not made the decision to follow Jesus, that's your first step. Bible verses I rattled off earlier. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We've got to understand that. We're all sinners. And the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And that's encouraging. Yeah, we've all sinned, we all deserve death, but Jesus Christ has given us this gift. Why? Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever should believe in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Because God demonstrated his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That's a great act of love. And Jesus was the only one, because Jesus, he said, I was the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. We want to know God. We want to get to heaven. Jesus is the way. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Jesus said, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him and he with me. It's that simple. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's the easiest thing in the world. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. By the way, Lord, that means you're going to place him as ruler of your life. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead and you will be saved. What a beautiful thing, how easy it is. It's not a whole lot of work. He did it all. If you've never done that, you need to accept it. And if you have, I encourage you. Bible study is just part of being a disciple. And Jesus said, if you want to be my disciple, then you need to deny yourself, take up the cross, and follow me. Three so important steps. If you want to learn how to do that, it's in God's Word. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to come and be here, to dine on your word, to be in your presence. And Lord, I thank you that this is not the only place and the only opportunity that we have throughout the week to open your word and to be in your presence and to worship you. In fact, we can do that daily. And so, Lord, I pray that in each and every person today, you would instill a new desire. Lord, that you would place hunger pangs within their very being for your word. Lord, that they'd understand it's not on bread alone, but it's on your word that we can be made full. And I pray for a new, greater understanding of your word. Holy Spirit, that as we dive in, that you would show us something new about yourself and that you would give us greater understanding of your word. And Lord, that you would give us the opportunity to then go out and apply it in our life, someone else's life, and all in a way that would bring you glory. Lord, we have to make the decision. I pray that every person in here would have the boldness and the courage to set aside time in your word, an opportunity to study. Lord, as they read through, if they have any questions, anything they don't understand, Lord, may they be willing to ask questions, to find those who would give them revelation, Lord, through your Spirit. May they turn to them, Lord, for the answers that you will provide. Gracious Father, we thank you for who you are and for being with us today. Please continue to guide and direct us this week, for it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.